Okay, good morning, everybody. Welcome back. Who's awake? So, okay. Welcome. I assume this is your first class of the spring semester, so I wish you all the best this semester. You are here for evolutionary robotics. If you're not, you're in the wrong room. We're all in the right room? Awesome. Okay. All right. So, first lecture of the course. We're going to spend a little bit of time going through the syllabus, going through the schedule, going through Brightspace, going through attendance, doing all the boring logistical stuff so we can move on to evolving robots. Fair? Sound good? All right, deep breath. Here we go. First of all, Brightspace. This course is administered from Brightspace. It's the first 5 minutes of the semester. We've already got a problem. There are two main sections of this course, CS3060, for those taking this course for undergraduate credit, and CS5060 for those that are taking this course for graduate credit. So far, so good. 3060, 5060. To make things complicated, there are two other cross listings of this course, CSIS5990 and BME, meaning Biomedical Engineering 5990. There are four different official names for this course designed to confuse and frustrate you. Okay, on Brightspace, you will find only two of the, I hope you will find only two of those course numbers, CS5060 and CSIS5990. It seemed to me as of late last night that all the students taking this course for undergraduate credit were signed up for CS5060. Is that what most of you see also through your Brightspace interface? Okay. I have no idea why. I'm working it out with the registrar. They may or may not fix it. For now, numbers don't matter. Those taking it for undergrad credit do everything through Brightspace 5060. And all the links will push you in the course, will push you in that direction. All of those that are taking the course for graduate credit, it looks like you are all assigned to CS5990. Grad students, did you end up on 5990 in Brightspace? Okay, so most important thing is we have the undergrads and graduates separated. Numbers don't matter so much. So far, so good? Okay, all right. All of this confusion is, of course, arising from the fact that UVM as a whole is instituting a whole new numbering scheme. This new numbering scheme is not to confuse and frustrate you. It's to gradually pull apart a number of courses on campus that are mixed undergraduate and graduate. This is one of those courses, yeah? So this course is halfway through being torn apart. You are all literally sitting here together, but the undergraduates and the graduates are gonna have a slightly different experience in terms of quizzes, assignments, expectations, office hours. We'll get to all that when we need to. For now, obviously, we are all here together in the classroom as it should be. Okay, so we're all here together. We are starting to split this course apart. There are two different syllabi, one for the undergrads, one for the grads. Those syllabi are very similar, but they are becoming, there's less and less overlap between them. So we're gonna go very quickly through the undergraduate syllabus, 3060. So we're all on the same page. And then I will very briefly talk about the 5060 syllabus for the grad students, and I will just point out where the differences are. So far, so good? All right. Obviously, we are here Tuesdays and Thursdays, bright and early at 8:30 in the morning. Some of you may be wondering why the heck you are here so early in the morning. The reason why is because I'm a morning person and I like to teach in the morning. So blame me. Okay. There's a link in the syllabus to the schedule. We'll talk about the schedule in a moment. I am obviously instructor for this course. Informality is fine with me. Call me Josh, that's fine. Okay, there's my email, and there's a link to how to see me for my office hours. I host people in person, remote, however you want to do it. All the instructions for how to visit me during office hours, you can find behind this link. Freya Feeney is the teaching assistant for this course. Freya could not be here this morning. Freya took this class last year, so all of the material is relatively fresh in her mind. There's her email. She also has a link to her office hours, and behind that link is the explanation of who, what, where, when, and how to see Freya. Okay. All right, here's the little blurb of the course that UVM makes me write. So let's go through this. This is my attempt to summarize what you're going to experience over the next 14 weeks. I have designed this course for you to explore the automated design of autonomous machines. We are going to see autonomy appear in this course over and over again. It's going to appear in two places. The machine or the robot itself is autonomous. The kinds of robots we're going to explore in this course are not remote controlled drones. They are autonomous machines. Machines that are sensing the world around them in real time and making decisions about what to do given that information in real time. That's the first level of autonomy. Second level of autonomy is what we have learned since the Second World War is making an autonomous robot that can make decisions on the fly and do it reliably and safely when it's around humans is extremely difficult. One of the most difficult engineering challenges or challenges full stop that our society has come up against. It is extremely difficult to sit down as an engineer or a software engineer or a computer scientist and design or train a robot by hand. So we as a society are in the process of figuring out how to automatically or autonomously design and train autonomous machines. Okay, that's my best attempt to summarize what we're gonna tackle in this course. Okay. Robotics is a huge, huge field. There are different kinds of camps and schools of thought within robotics, and we're going to see a lot of those different approaches to robotics, but we're going to sort of brush over them lightly, and we're going to drill down into one specific approach to automatically designing autonomous machines, which is instead of to train them or design them, we're going to evolve them. There are, or there should be, 64 autonomous machines, sorry, 65 autonomous machines sitting in this room. So we know it's possible to make autonomous and relatively safe machines to be around. Mother Nature has been doing it for 3.5 billion years. So we know there is one way to create autonomous machines, evolve them. That's the philosophy underlying this particular branch of robotics, evolutionary robotics. Not everybody in robotics agrees with that approach, and we'll get into all those interesting arguments and different approaches in a few weeks. Okay, as you will see as this course goes, this course is very, very broad. In order to evolve autonomous machines, we're going to have to draw on knowledge from a lot of different fields. We are not going to drill down very deep into any one field. We're going to take what we need from a lot of different fields and cobble them together. So, or you are going to cobble them together so that you can evolve robots on your laptop. Yeah. Okay. Some of the things we're going to see in this course include a particular kind of computational algorithm known as evolutionary computation. Evolutionary computation itself is a form of AI, so we've got some AI in there. We're going to see artificial neural networks. You've probably heard of deep learning. Deep learning is implements a particular kind of neural networks. So a little bit of evolutionary biology, a little bit of neuroscience. We're going to look at robotics. We're going to spend a bit of time talking about biomechanics, the science of how to move from point A to point B. You do it all the time. It feels effortless and obvious and therefore simple. It is absolutely not. So we're going to spend a fair bit of time talking about biomechanics. You're not going to be building real robots in this course. You're going to be simulating robots inside a physics engine inside your laptop. So we're going to spend a lot of time talking about physical simulation, physics engines, Newtonian mechanics. We're going to brush off our calculus a little bit. I'm sorry for that. for a little while when we talk about physical simulation. And at the end of the course, we're going to talk about these brand new creatures called computer-designed organisms, otherwise known as xenobots. This is a technology that has a lot of different names now. This is something that came out of my lab in a collaboration with a group at Tufts. It's going to be very much like what you see in this course. We're going to evolve simulated creatures in a physics engine in a laptop, and you could then go and 3D print a physical version of one of those virtual creatures, which would give you an autonomous robot that you build, or the 3D printer builds out of metals and ceramics and plastics and electronics and so on. Or you could send some of these evolved virtual creatures from your physics engine to a bioprinter and instead build that machine out of cells and blood vessels and tissues and neurons and synapses, and you would have a computer-designed organism or a biobot. We'll talk about that towards the end of the course. Okay, I'm already doing all the talking. Questions, comments? Anybody want to leave now? So far, so good? Okay, let's keep going. All right, so in order to communicate all of that information to you, at the end of it, what I hope you get out of it, these are my hopes for the learning outcomes for you. You might have other ideas about what you hope to get out of this course. I'd love to hear about it. Come talk to me in office hours. You should, by the end of this course, be able to design and simulate robot controllers. So the controllers are going to be these artificial neural networks that take in sensor information from the robot, transform that sensor information in some way, like your brain is doing right now with my words, and then transform that into actions. You should, at the end of this course, be proficient in using robot simulation tools to test and evaluate robot performance. You're going to be evolving hundreds or thousands, or depending on your laptop, millions of virtual robots over time. So you're going to be simulating and optimizing these machines in silico. Hopefully you will see that this technology is not perfect. You'll come to appreciate the limitations and challenges and open questions that remain in how to actually do this well, autonomously evolve autonomous machines. You should be able, by the end of this course, to evaluate and compare different robots, robot designs, control strategies using simulation. NASA hires you to develop a robot probe to go to Titan. Should you go with a wheeled robot, a legged robot, a flying robot? The body matters. How do we evaluate, compare, and contrast different approaches to designing autonomous machines to do whatever it is we want them to do? Okay, you will also become familiar in this course with evolutionary algorithms, which is the particular kind of AI we're going to be using in this course. But as I promised you, this is a broad course. We're going to talk a little bit about evolutionary algorithms, but just enough for you to use them to evolve robots. There is a sister course to this course called evolutionary computation, and it's going to be taught in the fall. If you find this topic interesting, I highly, highly recommend taking that sister course if you're able to. Okay, moving on to the nitty-gritty technology and tools. Again, UVM requires me to walk you through this. Obviously, as I've already said, we're going to be using Brightspace. You're going to be submitting all of your quiz responses, all of your assignment submissions to Brightspace. The TA and I will grade everything there, and you should be able to see your grade as you progress through this course on Brightspace. You can reach me on Teams, you can DM me there, you can DM the TA, DM your fellow students. Obviously, Teams is there for your use. I am currently recording this lecture. When we finish up, my office is actually on the back of that wall right there. I will go back to my office, upload this video to YouTube, and the link is usually live around midday. I will drop the resulting YouTube link into the schedule. So if for some reason you can't come to class, you can always watch the recorded lecture the afternoon of lecture days. Okay. As you'll see in a moment, all of the programming assignments you're going to be doing, all the instructions for how to execute those assignments are embedded in Reddit. I assume you're all familiar with Reddit. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Okay, we will be using Google Sheets for taking attendance. I'll come back and talk about attendance in a few minutes. You are going to be, over the next 10 weeks, you're going to be implementing 10 cumulative programming assignments. Each assignment builds on the one before. So over 10 weeks, you're going to be building a larger and larger code base. For most of the undergraduates in this course, I'm going to guess that this is probably going to be the biggest piece of code any of you have written to date. That may not be true for all of you, but for a lot of you, it will be. That is a very scary prospect. You're going to get to the point where the code base is so big that you can't remember sort of where everything is in the code base. It becomes extremely important that you maintain your code in a good way. And this is not a software engineering course. I'm not going to teach you about what that means, but you are going to be hosting or keeping all of your code as you go in GitHub. If you have not used GitHub before, I highly recommend you use this first week of the semester when things aren't too busy. Hop on YouTube. There are a gazillion GitHub tutorials. I'm happy to recommend some of my favorites. Just get on there, learn GitHub, practice, practice, practice this week. Have that ready to go. GitHub will be your friend in this course. It will help you track your progress. If you get to assignment 8 and you get over your head, everything's crashing, you don't know how to debug it, you're completely lost, GitHub will allow you to rewind the tape back to assignment 7 when everything was working, and then you can march forward again. Sounds trivial, super, super important. So far, so good. Questions, comments? You want me to repeat anything? Good? Okay, all right, let's keep going. The most controversial part of this course. This classroom is going to be a device-free course. I can see that there are many devices here today, perfectly fine. For today, you're allowed to have your laptop, your tablet, your brain computer interface, whatever you have, no problem. Thursday, no devices. I know for many of you, this is like asking you to chop off your right arm before you come to class. I get it. I understand. This is a controversial topic. My reading of the literature is that there is more and more evidence that students that come to class, listen to the instructor, watch the slides, take notes by hand with no devices, concentrate better, learn more, do better at the end of the course. That's what the data seems to say. I invite you to look at the literature. There's a growing number of published studies about classrooms with and without devices. To me, it seems evidence is suggesting devices don't have a place in the classroom. Fair?
Are we going to want to be taking pen and paper notes for the most part, or are the slides pretty comprehensive?
Good question. So how do you take notes in this class? There are many options. They're all fine with me. Come and take pen and paper notes. That's perfectly fine. All of the lecture material is going to be Google Slides, so you can write down pen and paper, slide 3, Bongard said blah, 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 and it wasn't on the slides. That's perfectly fine. Feel free to print out the Google Slides and bring them to class and annotate on top of the printed slides if you want. That's perfectly fine as well. Option C, take no notes during class, just listen, and then this afternoon, go back and watch the YouTube video at 200%, 500% speed, whatever works for you, and annotate with devices however you want. Yeah? Fair? So you got 3 different options for taking notes. For today, doesn't matter. Okay, all right, let's keep going. All right, lectures, as I just mentioned, each in-person lecture is recorded live, posted to YouTube. I'm going to do most of the talking today. Hopefully things will get a little bit more interactive when we get onto the actual material of the course. Please, please, please put up your hand, interrupt me, ask questions, offer ideas, criticize, offer a differing opinion. The more interactive these 75 minutes are, the more enjoyable and enriching it will be for you and for me. So please, please, please stop me at any time and ask questions. As I mentioned, I'm recording the video and audio right now, So what happens is if you ask a question and you go and watch the YouTube video later, you'll hear mumble, 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 and then you'll hear me say, great question, why does the robot do XYZ? Here's my answer. I will try and do that. So your voice may show up in the YouTube videos, but I guarantee you will not be identifiable from the video. Speaking of which, you can see, I think there are now 9 previous years of me teaching this course. You can go see some of those pre-recorded videos to see what they look like, or watch the one this afternoon. Okay, if you do speak up, your voice somehow is going to appear in the video. So remember, if you ask a question, you are tacitly agreeing to being recorded. All right? Okay. Okay. We've already kind of said this, versions of the lecture slides are posted online on the schedule. So before class starts, go and have a look at the schedule, print out the notes if you want, print out the slides if you want or not, that's perfectly fine. You will see, not today, but starting Thursday, the slide deck is going to be incomplete. From time to time, you'll see a slide pop up and there's going to be a red outlined box. And on my version, that box is going to be filled in with a little bit of text or a diagram or an equation. If you print out the slides and bring them to class, that box is going to be empty. That's a quiet reminder to you to annotate a little bit as we go. Yeah? Again, you will probably get more out of this course if you're writing something down during lectures than just passively listening. But again, it's up to you. When you go and watch the lecture, you will obviously, recorded lecture, you will obviously see my filled in version of the slides. Okay. All right. Given the way I've set up all of that, that usually means that if anyone needs accommodations like a note taker, all the rest, that's kind of obviated by the way we run this class. If you do need an accommodation, come and see me and I'm sure we can figure something out. Okay. All right. There is no required textbook for this course. There is an optional textbook. It's from 2008. Things are moving very fast in AI and robotics, as you probably know. So this textbook is hopelessly out of date. I have been asked by 3 different publishers to please write an updated textbook for evolutionary robotics. My answer to them and to you is, I'll get to it someday. For now, what we're going to do is, you're going to see there's a bunch of readings for this course. Some of them are going to be taken from this textbook. Most are going to be taken from the recent literature, papers that have been published over the last 5-10 years. Some of the readings are going to come from the 90s, and I think we're even going to go back to the 80s in some cases. So all the PDFs, everything you need to read, is in PDF form and it's embedded somewhere in the schedule at the appropriate time. We'll see that when we get to the schedule. Okay, there is a supplementary optional textbook, which is a book that I co-authored with my mentor, Roel Pfeiffer. If you buy this book, and please do, on Amazon, new, I think it's about $40. You could probably get a used version for less. Thanks to the wonders of modern publishing, if you buy a new copy of this book for $40, I will receive $1. So if I force all 64 of you to buy this book, I will be $64 richer. It doesn't seem worth my effort. Okay. All right, there will be a few snippets from that book sprinkled throughout the schedule as well. Okay, additional readings from the literature. Prerequisites. Hopefully, most of you have junior standing and above, and also programming experience. The number one question I get at the beginning of this course is, how much programming experience do you need for this course? I can't answer that question. In a few minutes, I will assign assignment 1 for you, and you can get started on the programming project, the programming assignments. I encourage you to do so this week, again, while things are relatively quiet. Especially if you're not sure whether you do have the programming chops for this course. If you get through assignment 1 and you start struggling already with assignment 2, my advice would be maybe this course is not right for you. If you're a junior, I invite you to withdraw and come back as a senior. If you breeze through assignment 1 and 2, you feel fine, no big problems, you're probably okay for this course. Okay, so short answer is you got to kind of answer this question for yourself. I can't police it or enforce it in any way. Use this time to figure it out for yourself. Okay, there's a few edge cases and exceptions. Though you probably know who you are, you've probably already come to see me and you're in this course. Okay. Okay, questions, comments? Okay, let's keep going. All right, grading scheme. Everything you have to submit, if you submit it one day late, 25% deduction, 2 days late, 50% deduction. If you submit stuff more than 2 days late, the TA will assign you a zero. I encourage you to submit on time. As I mentioned, all these programming projects are cumulative. It's like a math course. If you fall behind, it gets really, really hard to catch up because at week I, you have to redo or finish all the programming stuff from week I minus one before you can even start on the programming stuff for week I. Do not fall behind. If you do start to fall behind, don't panic. Number one thing, come and see me immediately. Unfortunately, at the end of this course, every year there are a handful of students who come to me at the end of the semester and say, I fell off the wagon in assignment three and I never recovered. There is nothing that I can do for you at that point in time if that's the situation. If you start to fall behind, come and see me and let's talk. All right. Just so we're all clear, you're going to get a percent grade at the end of this course, and I will convert it to one of these letters. All right. Okay, the spine and foundation of this course are the 10 programming assignments. Undergraduates, you're going to tackle one programming assignment each week. They're all available in Reddit, so you can race ahead as fast as you want. You can submit your solutions to those assignments as quickly as you want, as long as I've posted the assignments on Brightspace. By all means, run ahead. Again, why not? Things are quiet in the semester. Better to make some progress while things are quiet. But our cadence is going to be one. You're going to be submitting one programming project each week. Each one is worth 4%. Okay. What do these 10 programming projects do? At the end of it, you're going to have a physics engine running on your laptop. Inside that physics engine, you're going to see one robot after another trying to do some task. Walk from point A to point B, pick up an object, climb up some stairs, knock over another robot, you name it, doesn't really matter. Around that physics engine, so physics engine, inside the physics engine, a virtual robot, the physics engine is going to sit inside an evolutionary algorithm, which is evolving populations of robots in that physics engine. The robots in the physics engine that do a poor job at whatever it is you want the robots to do, the evolutionary algorithm will delete those robots. The surviving robots that are doing a slightly better job at whatever it is you want them to do, the evolutionary algorithm is going to make copies of them and introduce random mistakes when it's copying those robots. Right? Evolutionary algorithm, that's it. Rinse and repeat. That's what you will have at the end of the 10 weeks. Okay. All right. Quizzes. Every lecture day, there is a quiz due at 11:59 p.m. So today, quiz one is due at 11:59 p.m. It's available on Brightspace. Multiple choice quizzes, they're an annoyance for you. They're an annoyance for me. They are a gentle but steady prod to make sure you come to class or watch the recorded lecture, that you read the material, that you stay plugged in to this course. That's why they're there. Yeah. You'll see that their totals add up to something more than 25%. Ignore the total points. Just remember that however many quizzes we have over the span of this course, I'll sum up your total grade for all the quizzes and then normalize it to a grade out of 25%. Okay. If you come to class, if you do the reading, you should be able to breeze through the quiz in 10 minutes or less. They're not meant to be hard. They're just there to make sure you're reading and attending lectures in whatever form. Okay. All right. 10 weeks. We should have 4 or 5 weeks at the end of the semester. I haven't specced it out yet. That time is your own. You will have an evolutionary algorithm that's evolving robots on your laptop. You will, at the beginning of this four-week period, propose to the TA your final project. I now have a robot that walks from point A to point B, and it's a four-legged or quadrupedal robot. I propose over the next 4 weeks to create a hexapedal robot so that I've got one experiment in which there are four-legged robots and another experiment in which there are six-legged robots. And I want to see, my research question is, if the evolutionary algorithm evolves both of these, which one evolves to move faster? There's pros and cons to having four or six legs. What are they? Also pros to having two legs. What's an advantage of four over six, or vice versa?
I was gonna say like an advantage of six over four is that there's less stress on each of the legs if you have more legs.
Yeah, absolutely. So you've got six legs, a smaller fraction of your body weight, which maybe makes it easier for the evolutionary algorithm to evolve the robots to move quickly, maybe. Okay, absolutely. This planet is filled with four-legged animals that move very, very fast. So that's a pro for four legs.
Four would be cheaper.
Four would be cheaper. Cheaper in terms of what currency?
Like material-wise.
Material-wise, yeah. Maybe metabolically. We'll get to that when we get to biomechanics.
Six legs gives you like some redundancy if you break one of them.
Six legs gives you some redundancy. There are a gazillion insects on this planet right now that have five legs or four for whatever unfortunate reason. They get along just fine. So an advantage to six-legged robots is redundancy, mechanical redundancy. The advantage to four-legged robots is less material, less weight per leg. They're a little bit more highly efficient. It's not exactly obvious if you were to evolve speed, a fast gait for a four-legged robot or a six-legged robot, which one would win? That makes it a good research question. Try it out over 4 weeks, and at the end of the course, show us your results. Yeah, that's an example of a final project. We'll talk way more about final projects later. Okay. During those 4 weeks, you're going to be submitting weekly deliverables, basically proving to us that you're making progress and proving to yourself that you're not leaving it to the night before, as we all do. Okay. At the very end of the course, you'll submit a written report describing your experiment, and you will make an oral presentation during our exam period. There is no midterm, final exam in this course. There are 64 of you. There will probably be less than 64 of you at the end of this course. We got 3 hours for our exam period. You'll have about 2 or 2.5 minutes to present up here at the front of the class what you did during those 4 weeks.
Is this independent for each student, or is there collaboration?
These are independent projects. However many students there are in this class, that's how many final projects there are. You can chat with your fellow students. Hey, what are you working on? What's your research question? What are you doing? Hey, that's a great idea. Do you mind if I incorporate it into my project? If you do, please just document those collaborations in here, but you and you alone will be assigned a grade for your final project. Okay. All right. Participation. There is a 5% grade for participating in this class. Why do we do that? Again, this is a gentle prod to make sure that you stay engaged with the material. We're going to move pretty fast in this course, at least probably from the undergraduate's perspective. This is a mixed undergraduate and graduate class. We're going to move fast, cover a lot of material. You're going to be writing a lot of code. I want you to stay plugged into this class. I don't want to lose you. So come to class, or quote unquote, come to class, watch the recorded video in the afternoon. Okay, how do we track participation? We do it in the following way. In person, every morning, I will write up a unique link. First thing you do when you come to class, get out your device, go to that link. It'll take you to a Google Sheet. Just find your name and check yourself off for that day. Please go ahead and do so now.
don't.
Is there a typo, huh? Okay.
It's lowercase f.
This is a lowercase f. Thank you. Lowercase f. Is it working?
Yes.
Good. Hands up when you've checked yourself off. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 20, 30. Okay, hands down. Okay, struggle on. I'm going to carry on. Okay, if you're sick, if something happens and you can't come to class, that means you will not know what the link is for the attendance sheet for that day. Watch the recorded lecture in the afternoon. That as you're watching that recorded lecture, there will be a bit.ly link that will pop up at a random time point in that recorded lecture at some point. It'll stay up for about 30 seconds and then it'll disappear again. Why am I putting you through all these hoops? To prod you to watch the video lecture. Yeah? So you can mark yourself as here by coming to class and doing this, or you can mark yourself off as here by watching the pre-recorded lecture, finding the bit.ly link, and checking yourself off. Yeah?
And that has to be done the day of.
It has to be done the day of. Yes, good point. Tonight at 11:59 p.m., this link will become inactive. Yeah? Again, I realize this is painful and frustrating and it's got a lot of steps to it. I've taught this course for many years. This is the best solution I've come up with to prod you to stay engaged. Fair? All right. Okay. Okay. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Okay. If you find that you have missed three classes, and you'll be able to see this growing attendance sheet over time. So you'll see your own gaps. If you see that you've missed three classes and you're about to miss a fourth class, email me or come and see me. Stuff happens. I don't expect perfect attendance. If you miss three or fewer classes, you will get the 5%. If you miss four or more classes and you didn't come see me and give me a reason, you will get zero for participation. Fair? Okay. Okay. That's the syllabus. Questions? Yes?
For the last one, if you miss class and watch the lecture, is that kind of missing class?
If you miss class in the morning, you watch the video lecture, you find the bit.ly link, and you mark yourself off on the attendance sheet by the end of lecture day, all good. Anything else I can clarify? Okay, so that's for those taking undergraduate credit. Let's switch to those taking this for graduate credit. Everything is almost exactly the same. I made a few last minute changes this morning, so I want to just highlight those. Everything else should be more or less the same. For the grad students, Freya is still your TA for the first 5 weeks. Starting in week six, I will be your TA, and I'll explain why in a moment. And that's explained down here. Okay, let's see. Okay, this is all the same. Okay. Graduate students, you are going to be doing the 10 programming projects I just mentioned for the undergraduates, but you're going to be doing them double time. You're going to be doing two of those programming projects per week. So you will be done with all 10 of those programming projects at the end of week five. You're then going to redo everything, but you're going to do it in a differentiable simulator, which may not mean a lot to all of you, but it is a big, 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 big deal. And we'll talk about why shortly. Evolving robots in a differentiable simulator is much more difficult than evolving robots in the physics engine that you're all going to be using for the first 10 programming projects. So for the grad students, you're going to get comfortable with all the bits and pieces of robotics: sensors, motors, physics engines, biomechanics, neural networks, neurons, synapses, hidden layers, all that stuff. You'll be doing it in a traditional physics engine to familiarize yourself with it. Then you're going to dive in starting in week 6 through week 10 and do all those 10 assignments again in a differentiable simulator for a total of 20 programming assignments. So for the grad students, those are all, each assignment is worth only 2%. So for both grads and undergrads, you're going to 40% of your effort is implementing programming assignments. We'll talk way more about differentiable simulation and what's going to be expected when we get there in week 6. All good? Okay. This was just a typo. This is fixed. Okay. Everything else is the same. Anything else? Okay. All right, that's the syllabus. Let's switch to the schedule. Can people read this in the back of the room?
It's pretty small.
It's pretty small. Okay, let me zoom in. All right, so at the beginning of class, in-person class, I'll put up the schedule. So as you're coming to class and getting settled, have a look, and the schedule should very quickly remind you where we are, where we've been, and where we're going. Yeah? Okay, I'm gonna zoom out for a moment. Bear with me. I don't expect you to be able to read this. Okay, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different themes in this course. There are 6 parts of this course. There are 6 aspects of evolutionary robotics we're gonna explore in this course. The first of the 6 themes is intro. What, why are robots? A short history of AI. As we all know, so there are some pretty exciting things happening in AI and robotics at the moment. You need to know a little bit about where those two fields have been and maybe where they're going. We'll talk a little bit about the philosophical underpinnings of robotics. Intro, setting the stage. Second part of the course is the nuts and bolts, the tools of the trade. We're going to talk about the 3 main parts that you're going to need to implement to get your evolutionary robotics experiment up and running. That's theme number 2. Theme number 3, we're gonna go through the history, not the history of robotics, but we're gonna go through the history of evolutionary robotics. What's been explored so far? Robotics is an interesting field, as is AI, because there are a lot of open questions. We don't have any robots running around at the moment, because it's super hard. The short answer is we don't know how to do it yet. We don't know how to create autonomous machines that are simultaneously useful and safe. To me, this is the number one thing that makes this area so exciting. Maybe some of you will eventually come up with an answer to some of these unanswered questions. So in the third theme, 4th theme, we're gonna look at some of these open challenges. Some of the things that are holding back progress, not just in evolutionary robotics, but probably in robotics in general. Okay, that's theme number 4. Theme number 5, collective robotics. There are many, many, many things that we would like machines to do that humans currently do, that those humans would absolutely prefer not to do those jobs. A lot of those jobs are literally big jobs and would be impossible for any single machine to do. We would like to create a group of machines that are ultimately able to do that job that's beyond the ability of a single machine, and humans currently do them, but they prefer not to do them. How do we marshal effort? How do we get machines to cooperate and do something together that would be beyond the ability of any one machine? 6th and final part of this course, we're going to explore what makes evolutionary robotics so special, which is that in evolutionary robotics, unlike all the other branches of robotics, evolutionary robotics focuses on designing not just the brain of the robot, but the body as well. Your body and your brain were sculpted simultaneously and continuously over the last 3.5 billion years. Mother Nature didn't design bodies de novo and then tinker with brains. She doesn't work that way. In every other branch of robotics, that's what roboticists do. They hire engineers to build a dog robot or a humanoid robot, fire the engineers, and then they bring in computer scientists to apply AI to train the brain of the robot. It's madness. It's ridiculous. It is absolutely not how Mother Nature does things. So evolutionary roboticists, and I'm one of them, have put our money down on the table, and we've made a particular bet that if we ultimately want to make useful and safe machines, we're going to have to create AI that sculpts body and brain together, more or less like the way Mother Nature did with us. That's what makes evolutionary robotics unique, and that's what we'll really spend time with in the very last part of the course. You'll notice on the schedule that there's four open slots here. A lot of these 23 lectures take more than 75 minutes, so some of them will spill out into the next lecture. I will update the schedule as we go, and these lectures will bubble down and eventually fill up these four open slots. Any questions about that? Yes?
So we should be coming here every week to do the reading and find the video, not...
You don't have to come here. You don't have to come to class if you can't. To the sheet. Yes. Yes, you do have to come to this sheet, to the schedule. I would suggest you bookmark this and tattoo it on your forehead so you see it every morning in the mirror. This is probably the most important document in the course. I sort of pepper links, all of our links in here. So if you're confused about what we're doing today, what's expected of you for this week, it's all here in the schedule, which is embedded in Brightspace, embedded in the syllabus. Shouldn't be hard to find this document. So far, so good? Okay, so here's today, and hopefully we will get to the first set of slides in a few minutes. There's the link to the slide deck. When I go back to my office, you'll see that the lecture for Thursday, I will embed a link to Thursday's lecture. So again, you can download that, print it out, have it electronically available, whatever you want. I sort of keep one lecture ahead of all of you. You'll notice that there is a quiz that's already available for the undergraduates and a quiz available for the graduate students. There's the reading for today. So if you haven't already, sometime today, do the reading and by 11:59 p.m., take the quiz. And if you've marked yourself as present, you're done with this course for today.
So the readings are like necessary to
close. The required reading is. Some weeks, some lectures, there'll be optional reading as well. Everything that appears on the quiz is something that's embedded in the lecture slides or is very prominent in the reading. I am not going to torture you by asking you a question about some esoteric detail deep in the reading or something I mentioned offhand in class. The quizzes aren't meant to be difficult. If you come, listen to me, watch the slides, do the reading, go to the quiz, you should be done in 10 minutes. All good? Okay. All right. These columns here, you will see that the first of the 10 programming assignments has been assigned to the undergraduates, and the first of the two programming assignments have been assigned to the grad students. And sorry, I'm going to have to zoom out for this. Okay. Next Monday, assignment one is due. You should submit your assignment, your first assignment to Brightspace by 11:59 p.m. next Monday. Yeah, basically a week from now. Question?
So are the programming assignments like approachable pretty independently from the lectures?
Yes. You will find that the lectures and the programming assignments are actually quite independent.
This document is, I can't find it.
Yep, if you go to Brightspace, In Brightspace, you should find a link to the syllabus. And on the main page of Brightspace, yep. And at the top of the syllabus, you'll find a link to the schedule. And I'm sorry if I forgot to embed the schedule directly in Brightspace as well. Okay, I will maybe clean things up when I get back to my office. I will try and make the syllabus and schedule very clear at the top of Brightspace. Okay. Okay, right, so for the undergraduates, next Monday night, assignment one is, you have to submit assignment one. Undergrads, you have to submit assignments one and two by Monday night. Next Tuesday, a week from now, in class, I will say a few brief words about assignment two for the undergrads, and I will say a few brief words about assignment three and four for the grads. I am not going to explain all the assignments in class. Class is for lecture. Go do the assignments. As I mentioned, you can run ahead as quickly as you want. At the moment, you can run up to and including assignment two. If you want clarification about the assignment, something isn't obvious, email me, Teams me, email or Teams the TA, come see us in office hours, and we'll hash it out. Okay. Any questions about any of that? Okay, so that's the syllabus and the schedule. We're gonna finally get to the lecture notes for today. We got 25 minutes left, so that's good. We are going to, on Thursday and the beginning of next week, talk about the what of robotics. What actually is a robot? What's the distinction between a robot and a non-robot? We'll talk about that. The majority of, well, the rest of the course, 99.9% of the class, will talk about the how of robotics. How do you evolve a capable robot? How do you evolve a safe robot? How do you evolve a capable and safe robot? How do you evolve swarms of robots? How do you evolve robots made of cells rather than metal? How? We'll spend most of our time on this. Hopefully today and a bit of tomorrow, we'll talk about the why of robotics. The number one question I get asked by reporters when we publish something is, why the heck are you trying to make the Terminator? You, your family members, when you tell them about this course, they're probably gonna ask you the same question. You'd better have a pretty good answer. I'll give you my answers. I want you to come up with your own. Is it worth it for our society to try and autonomously design autonomous machines? Or maybe it's a bad idea? Yeah? We'll talk a little bit about that. Okay, before we even get to the why, however, let's start with the who. The who in this question that you can see here. This is Sam Kriegman. Sam was initially an undergraduate here at UVM and took this course 9 years ago. Sam went on, after taking this course, to sign on to be my PhD student. He spent 5 years here with me. When he finished up with me, he went and did a postdoc for 1 year at Tufts, and he is now a professor at Northwestern University working on evolutionary robotics. What I'm going to show you here, this was Sam explaining evolutionary robotics live on the CBS Evening News. My hope for some of you is that you get interested in this topic, you do some interesting work in evolutionary robotics, and 8 or 9 years from now, you end up having to explain what you're working on live on national television.
Robots can reproduce. It's actually happening at a lab near Boston, Massachusetts. For tonight's Weekend Journal, we take you there to find out what this remarkable discovery could mean for all of us. Inside this lab at the Allen Discovery Center at Tufts University, scientist Douglas Blackiston shows me the petri dish.
So these are frog embryos.
Where xenobots, also known as robots, live. They are robots, but not made of metal and circuit boards.
Why do they call them robots when it really feels like it's just a small, very, organism?
They're robots because they're designed and engineered from the ground up
to behave in very specific ways. These are returned to the original conception of the word robot, which is just a worker made out of living tissue.
Sam Kriegman is on a team of three other researchers who've been working on this project since 2018. A closer look through the microscope shows tiny, uniquely shaped organisms derived from one-day-old frog eggs on the move.
They are swimming around in a dish, pushing other cells into piles.
This is actually how they reproduce. A supercomputer reshapes the organisms, giving them a Pac-Man-like appearance. The manufactured mouth then collects single cells placed in the petri dish, which eventually form into identical replicas of the original.
Is it all about the shape?
Yes, everything we've done is just simply the shapes. You can imagine shapes really important. We can play with the molecular biology and the genetics as well to push the cells to do things they normally would.
These researchers believe these tiny organisms could one day do big things in the field of regenerative medicine.
So if we fully understood how cells decide to build things, then we should be able to control it, to make them build other things, to stop growth during cancer, and to restart growth to regenerate limbs or other organs.
It's possible these organisms could even help the Earth recover from environmental disasters like oil spills.
It shows us that there are many kinds of ways that nature can be creative and reproduce itself.
How far are we away from that?
We are far away, but we...
How far? Will we still be here?
I hope so. That's my goal, yeah. Is to do something useful in our lifetime.
And the Department of Defense is funding the project. Scientists tell us the DoD funds hundreds of medical and scientific research projects each year.
Okay. There's one possible endpoint for you 8 or 9 years from now. As I mentioned, Sam was my student, got to explain all this live on national television. His advisor ended up on a different program.
To make the reproducing robots, researchers using AI and a supercomputer took stem cells from African clawed frog embryos and formed them into tiny living creatures called xenobots, which were able to move on their own, communicate amongst each other, and heal themselves from an injury, making them the first ever living robots. Which is when researchers bulldozed the lab, dropped flash grenades into the rubble, and went back to their first love, stand-up comedy. What's that? No? They kept going? Sweet. Then the xenobots would move around their environment and find single cells. They would gather hundreds of these cells at once and then assemble an offspring inside their mouth. A few days later, the offspring became a new xenobot. And that's when researchers doused the building in jet fuel, walked away from the smoking ruins, and took up selling driftwood sculptures on the beach. No? Still making them puke robot babies? Super dupe. As one of the experts working on the project, Josh Bongard, put it, we found xenobots that could walk. We found xenobots that swim. And now in this study, we found xenobots that kinematically replicate. What else is out there? A beach? A pocket knife? And your imagination. Please just think about it. We'll be right back.
Okay, I know there's some wonderful driftwood on North Beach. Should I retire? I'm not going to. Let's keep going. Okay, as he said, let's keep going. Okay, hilarious, obviously. Happy to take some jokes at my expense. This is an issue when you work in robotics and AI. Why the heck are we trying to do what we're doing? What happens if we succeed? Something that we will spend some time talking about in this course as well. Okay, all right. So moving on from the who to the why. Why might we want to try and do this? I will now give you my answer, but I hope over the span of this course, you start to come up with some of your own answers. What's the difference between the top pair of photographs and the bottom pair of photographs? Yep.
Intelligence.
Intelligence, how so?
I guess formulaic to us input and make decisions, whereas the top things are very set in their ways.
Okay, you use the term non-formulaic. The machines in the bottom pair of images are doing something non-formulaic, and the machines in the top pair of images are doing something formulaic. Can we maybe be a little bit more specific?
The top images are in a constrained working environment designed for efficiency and automation. Even the people are semi-automated, they're doing an assembly line. The bottom ones, it's external in an environment way less structured, people just moving around what needs to be done, and yeah, it looks less automated.
Absolutely, right? So the number one distinction, the main distinction between the top pair and the bottom pair is structured environments in the top pair and unstructured environments in the bottom pair. It's a technical term, but it basically means it's kind of chaos in the bottom and everything's very clear in the top pair of images. The top left image, let me turn off the lights so you can see a little better. The top left image, this is a snapshot from one of Henry Ford's very first factories. And factories were designed by Ford and others over 100 years ago now to create a structured environment, a simplified environment in which the machines or the workers, in this case, human workers, are able to ignore all the chaos of the real world and focus on just doing one thing. Each specialized worker here does one very specific minor task of self-assembly to, in this case, build motorcycles. Yeah? So Henry Ford over 100 years ago systematized the way that we build things indoors. And then about 100 years later, in the 60s and 70s, robotics started to emerge and robots started to replace humans that automated the way that we build things indoors. So systematization of manufacture, automation of manufacture. This was a proof that machines are very useful. They can help us make things much faster, much more cost effectively. So from an engineering and economic point of view, there's a very good answer to the why of robotics. Why are most factories in the West completely automated now? There's a good reason for that. Of course, it gets complicated. There are second order effects or knock-on effects, less jobs in manufacturing. There's also economic fallout for others that are not so fortunate, and we'll talk about that. If robots are so useful for building things indoors, why have we not deployed robots to help us build things out of doors? One of the number one national priorities in this country is shoring up our literally crumbling infrastructure. Buildings, roads, bridges, dams, you name it. Clearly, we would be able to fix outdoor infrastructure much more cost effectively and better if we had robots doing it than people doing it. Why have we not done it? Yes, near the back.
It takes more complex decision making.
It takes more complex decision making? Why does it take more complex decision making?
There's just so many more variables.
There's so many more variables. Did you have an idea? You can't predict, right? You can't predict the weather. There's a snowstorm coming today at some point, right? Okay, this is it. So we are stuck at the moment. We're making a little bit of progress. As we know, autonomous vehicles are kind of here. They're kind of coming. Why? They're kind of halfway here. Why are they halfway here?
The road is like constrained, like it's always gonna look the same, but the things crossing it and the things next to you are always different.
So a road, and especially a highway, is somewhere between the controlled environment of a factory and the completely uncontrolled world of human affairs, right? If we could just keep these pesky humans off every road and highway, just outlaw it outright, autonomous vehicles maybe would be here, right? can't quite do that, so autonomous vehicles are kind of here. The bleeding edge, the place where we're stuck, is creating autonomous machines that can make complex decisions in unstructured environment. We can't prepare them for everything. That being said, Mother Nature has produced a large number of autonomous machines, and most of us, knock on wood, survive years or decades before we give up the ghost. We manage to survive and thrive in this chaotic world where you're never, ever performing the same action twice. The Greek philosopher Heraclitus is reported to have said over 2,000 years ago, man never enters the same river twice. Some of you may have had a class, had a course taught in this room before. Maybe you're sitting in the same seat, maybe you're not. Most of you have not had a class with me before. Presumably you've never seen these slides before. The pattern of light falling on your retinas right now is completely unique. At every instant of time, it is a wondrous fact that with that constant novelty being thrown at you, you manage to keep yourself fed, clothed, sufficiently warm, not too warm, and so on. We don't know yet how animals and humans do that. If we did, we'd have autonomous and safe machines that could work at construction sites. They could do your dishes. They could shovel the snow. We don't. So there are very good economic and engineering reasons for why we want robots. There are very, very deep philosophical and intellectual reasons for why we can't. And the purpose of this course is to try and identify exactly what those problems are and come up with new solutions. Some of you may eventually contribute to that goal. So far, so good? Question?
Go deeper into any of like, the politics of it.
Oh,
like,
we will
make robots because then you take jobs from people who are.
Yeah, we will talk a little bit about the politics, the ethics, the morality of robotics towards the end of the course, especially when we talk about xenobots. We're not gonna spend a lot of time talking about it. It is a very, very important topic. If I could clone myself, I'd teach another course called The Ethics of Robotics, but we will definitely talk about it. I would encourage you to, during these Q&A sections during lecture, bring it up. We're gonna see lots of different robots. We're gonna come at this issue from a lot of different directions. Remind me, prompt me, I'm more than happy for us to discuss it here in lecture. We're gonna spend most of our time, however, talking about how to actually create them. So far, so good? Okay, back to the why for a moment. What I've just shown you is some engineering reasons. Personally, I think there are some very good scientific reasons for why we want to create robots. If we did, we would have another example of intelligent machines aside from us. In my opinion, there are relatively few open frontiers left in basic science. There's a lot of questions remaining about evolutionary biology, but there's a guiding framework that's already in place that Darwin discovered 150, 70 years ago. There's sort of a framework in which we ask and answer questions about biology. In physics, there are two frameworks within which we ask and answer questions about physics, the Newtonian framework and the quantum framework. Right? Again, so there are lots of questions in physics and biology, but there's a frame. There's also a guiding frame for chemistry. What is it? Chemistry isn't the Wild West. We don't just ask random research questions about various chemical elements. What's the guiding framework? In high school science, whenever you talked about chemistry, what's the very first thing you see?
The laws of thermodynamics.
Laws of thermodynamics are very important. They're not the first thing you see.
But the periodic table.
The periodic table, right? Thank you, Mother Nature. It turns out there's some fundamental structure in all the Lego bricks that make up our universe. Amazing, right? It's there. It guides and frames the kinds of questions we ask about in chemistry. What's the guiding theory for intelligence? What makes you intelligent and not this? What makes you intelligent and a bacteria less intelligent? You go to Google or ChatGPT and start asking them, you'll get all sorts of answers. The embarrassing fact, in my opinion, no one knows. A lot of people say it's the brain. That's the answer. If we're going to understand intelligence, we need to understand the brain more. It's so obvious. That's where intelligence is. We should focus on the brain. There are a minority of people working in AI and robotics who say, that's not it. Or it's not sufficient. Maybe the brain is part of the answer, but it's not the whole answer. I don't expect you to agree with me. I'm just trying to illustrate that there is fundamental disagreement about framing questions about intelligence. In my opinion, there are several Nobel Prizes waiting to be won in this area. It's the Wild West. It's the open frontier. If you want to be a scientist and discover something amazing that changes people's views about us, human nature, intelligence, this is it. This is the place to be. Okay. Another intellectual answer to why study robotics is it's very interdisciplinary. In order to make progress on making useful robots, you can't just study mechanical engineering. It's not enough. As I've already said, and you'll see in this course, we're going to talk about evolution, we're going to talk about the brain, we're going to talk about the mind, we're going to talk about human nature, human behavior, the biomechanics, the physics of moving, physics, when we talk about physics engines, you're going to do a lot of coding in this class. We're going to look at a lot of physical robots. And along the way, we're going to talk about mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, bioengineering. You're going to see some robots that actually make use of some exotic chemistry towards the end of this class. There's some math in this class. It's not a very mathy class, but we'll do some. We're going to revisit philosophy. I already introduced you to Heraclitus. There's a philosophical underpinning to robotics as well. I challenge you to think of any other branch of science or engineering that has this breadth. This is one of the things that, for me, makes robotics so exciting. Okay, we've got 4 minutes left. I will pause for a moment. Questions, comments? Okay, back to the practicalities for a moment. Why make robots? We, as a society, obviously have some very big and very scary global challenges in front of us. Most, if not all of them, trace their origins back to our inability to collect enough clean energy to do all the things we want to do. We are in the process, as a global society, of trying to wean ourselves off of fossil fuels. Most of the solutions have this form: a very, very big wind farm, solar farm, mirror farm, wave farm, tide farm. In all of these farms, there's a whole bunch of machines that are doing something. Some of them are in structured environments. Some of them are in unstructured environments. All of them need regular maintenance. The biggest single cost of any of these farms, what do you think? If you want to deploy and maintain a solar farm,
paying people to maintain it.
Labor, human labor cost. At the moment, it's a good thing. It's invigorating our economy. Doesn't scale very well. Maybe robots can help us here. Who knows? We'll see. Okay. We've got 2 minutes left, so let's finish by visiting outer space. I will start this video, but I'm going to mute it. Okay. This is a video from, I think, about 6 or 7 years ago. NASA is considering making tensegrity probes. You're looking at a tensegrity. A tensegrity is a particular kind of mechanical structure that's got a lot of interesting properties. And you can visually, without understanding much about tensegrity structures, you can kind of intuit what the advantage of tensegrity structures are. They can land on a surface, like the surface of a planetary body. And when they do, they absorb a lot of the shock so that the fragile inner part, which is maybe the scientific instruments or a human astronaut, are safe. NASA's not sure whether they're going to send these out into the solar system in the next 15, 20 years, but they're thinking about it. One of the problems, I just told you about one of the advantages of tensegrity robots. One of the challenges of tensegrity robots is how do you control this thing? You'll notice these little thin lines. These are metal threads. In the middle of these metal threads, it's hard to see in this video, there's a little motor that's tugging inward on these metal threads. That's what's making this thing move. How do you design one of these things? How do you control one of these things? All of the theory that's been developed in engineering about how to control cars and robot arms and space stations, cellular phones, none of it applies to these crazy things. What are these researchers at NASA doing? They're evolving these potential rovers in simulation and then trying to make some of these, more or less exactly what you're going to be doing in this course. I'm going to flick the lights back on. Okay, something to dream about for the rest of the day. Just as a reminder, you have a quiz due tonight. You can start working on assignments 1 and 2. I'll talk a little bit more about assignment 1 and 2 Thursday morning. See you then.